All right, school board meeting called to order for Tuesday, October 20th, 2020. Roll call, Ms. Jenkins.
Ms. Richards? Mr. Taylor?
Here.
Ms. Abrams?
Here.
Mr. Westmoreland?
Present.
Mr. Duncan?
Here.
Mr. Bush?
Here.
Mr. Moore?
Here.
Ms. Simmons?
Here.
Ms. Dominguez?
Present.
All right, thank you. I'm asking you if you would please stand, and we will have our Pledge of Allegiance National Anthem brought to us virtually by Sumner High School.
Okay.
Hopefully.
Yes, yes.
Otherwise, Robin's going to sing.
Good evening. My name is Ms. Shaughnessy Matthews, Principal of Jules Sumner High School here in Kentwood, Louisiana. Please join my student, Ms. Destiny Warren, who's a senior here at Jules Sumner High School, in the National Anthem and the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Now for our national anthem. Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Thank you. You may be seated. I think that's a good use of technology, wouldn't you agree?
Right.
Absolutely. All right. Item 1C, consider approval of board minutes from October 6, 2020. Do I hear a motion that we accept those?
I'll make the motion to approve them.
Motion by Ms. Simmons.
Second.
Second by Mr. Westmoreland. Electronic voting.
Voting is open. Voting is closed with Mr. Moore voting no.
Okay. Item 2A, recognition. I think Dr. Hurst, you're going to handle Ms. Verna Thompson for being named School Nurse Coordinator of the Year.
Yes, sir. I want to switch and do Ms. Poche first, if that don't mind, board.
That's fine.
Good evening, board and Ms. Steele. Thank you for this opportunity. This was supposed to happen in March. The week after we shut down, we got a phone call that we have two nurses in our parish who were nominated for Nurse of the Year, and both of them were selected. So that in itself, that says we have two individuals that got Nurse of the Year in this parish, is an accomplishment in itself. So first, I want to call up Ms. Alicia Poche. Just to give you a little history, She started out at Huey Long Hospital Emergency Room. She worked at Charity Hospital New Orleans Emergency Room, Ochsner Hospital, and she's been with Tangipahoa Parish School System since 1995. Alicia worked with elementary students for the past 25 years. She taught the first nurse aid program in Tangipahoa Parish. She has been a student and family advocate for many families that were in need of assistance for basic needs as well as medical needs. She is patient, loving, and respectful to her students. She is diligent and even attends after school events to ensure the safety of her diabetic students. Ms. Poche is the daughter of Bill and Charlene Mertens, wife to Patrick Hall, sister to William Mertens, mother of four, Derek, Danielle, Caitlin, Jared, grandmother to nine, Brock, Ava, Noah, Myla, Jordan, Jackson, Samantha, and Robert. Ms. Poche, I proudly present you with this plaque from Tangipahoa Parish School System. Congratulations to the Parish School System. Proudly recognizes Alicia Poche, 2019-2020 Louisiana School Nurse Organization School Nurse of the Year.
Thank all my girls, all my friends, y'all. Y'all are wonderful. Can't do it without you. Thank you.
What up, family? Please stand. Okay. The next individual that I'm about to introduce, I cannot say enough about. She is the individual that holds the nursing department together. When I tell you that she makes my job easy, because one, I don't know anything about nursing. So when she comes and say, hey, this is what's going on, this is what needs to happen, Ms. Verna, whatever you say. You're the person, you call the shots, so we're gonna follow your lead. And all we do is support her. And I believe her staff really loves her. So Ms. Verna started out at Lolly Kemp Regional Medical Center as a staff nurse. She was promoted to head nurse for the surgery ward 3 years later. She worked at San Helena Community Health Center, Tangipahoa Parish School System employee since 1998, taught CNA program for 3 years, then transferred to the school nurse position and was responsible for four schools, approximately 3,000 students. She served as a school nurse for 18 years. Presently, she has served as head nurse since 2016. So now she's over 32 schools and 20,000 students. Ms. Verna is the most compassionate and caring leader. She truly loves each of her staff nurses and as family. She supports us and encourages us always. Working for Ms. Verna is truly a blessing. We can do our jobs and know that we have the support and backing of Ms. Verna with confidence. She pushes each of us to be our best and reminds us of the reason we do the job for the children, and that was Ms. Carrie Watts. So, Ms. Verna.
Would you please come up?
I'm going to present you with this plaque for becoming the Louisiana School Nurse Organization School Nurse Coordinator of the Year.
I want to thank everybody that's here tonight. You know that you're only as strong as your weakest link, and I look at myself to be the weakest link. You know, I have to commend my team, because it doesn't take much for me to ask them to do something and the job is done. I don't know another department that can be so blessed to have the team that we have. It's more than just a team, we're family. I also want to recognize my family that's here. It's exciting to see everyone. And just know the support that you have at home. One thing's for sure is I live with COVID more than I live with my husband right now. So, you know, a lot's got to be said for that as well. But I wanted to thank everybody, you know, and just let everybody know that I'm here to do the job that needs to be done.
I'd like to also recognize any nurses that work for the system. And now, would you please stand? Woo. Boy, I just want to say, during this COVID, these ladies have put in overtime trying to track students, find out who is exposed, contacting parents. Ms. Verner rarely leaves here before 8, 9 o'clock in the evenings trying to track parents down that late at night. I've even stayed up here with her sometimes, for one time, that she asked me to. So, thank you, ladies, for what you do.
You know, Dr. Hurst, I'd also add, I saw Ms. Verner, for people that don't know, and I saw her again. And 2 weeks later, I'd see her again in a board meeting. So I went up to her one and I said, what are you doing here? She said, I made a commitment to be at every school board meeting. So this is not just the first one she's been in. I think she comes to every one of them. And I just want to say thank you for all the work that you do.
Absolutely. She told me I tattled because I called her baby brother, Mike, to get him here tonight. But I could have called a bunch of other brothers because you got a big crew. But I do appreciate Mike coming tonight and support. Exactly. But congratulations to both of you.
Yes, thank you, Ms. Verner. We see you out there every meeting. We appreciate you so much, and all you nurses, too.
I think it's kind of fitting that we were supposed to do this in March, and then it got postponed, because if we didn't love you in March, we definitely love you today, because a lot of stuff's changed. So thank you for all your hard work. All right, before we get to 3A, I'm going to move up. We have two public inputs, and out of respect for the candidates, I know they're busy. We want to give them a chance to introduce themselves to the body that's here. And I'm going to ask Mr. Bush if he would introduce Mr. Deliberto first.
Thank you, Mr. President. All I can say is Charlie Burt Deliberto requested it. He showed up tonight wanting to address the board and the public. And sir, let me just say, in the 7th Ward, I can speak for all of our families and children. You want to be a part of our school system with mentoring and et cetera. I appreciate that so much because we need all the help we can get. And thank you for offering your services if you become Marshall to work with our school system, as Daniel Edwards does in Dare or Robbie Miller does in Litter. Thank you, sir. Charlie Burt Deliberto.
Thank you very much, Bush. Thank you, Mr. Kelly, and the school board members for having me. My name is Charles Deliberto. I'm a retired police officer of 32 years from the city of Hammond. I've worked in every division there was. I'm just gonna take a few minutes and tell you part of my deal that I like to do when I do make Marshall is to help the school board as much as I can. And in doing that, I would like to help with after school programs to assist anything I may have that you have going on. I would like to help with the kids, I don't know how you pronounce, how you say, but the kids that don't go to school, the truancies, if I could help you with that, the school board, I would like to help with that. I would like to take a deputy and bring a deputy into the school systems, into the 7th Ward, not every day, but when needed, and just a walk through with the principal if he or she may need one, just to be seen. I also like to help with any kind of football games, athletic, football games, baseball, whatever may go on, to do the escorts, to provide security for your schools and whatever is needed. And also the homecoming parades we have, because they always, you know, I see them over my 32 years, they've always had homecoming parades up until this year. And we've always escorted them through the police department, and I like the marshal's office take a piece of that also and help out. And anything that your school or the homes or the children that you may need, I would like for you to call upon me when I make Marshall so I can help you and give back to what y'all do for us. I thank you. My number is 76 on the ballot. I'm Charles Deliberto.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
we have Mr. Colt Four also, and he is running for in the judge's race. Colt, you want to come up and address the board? Thank you for coming.
Yeah, thank y'all for having me. For those of you I have not met, my name is Colt Four. I'm running for district judge in Division F. That's Judge Wolf's old seat. She moved up to the First Circuit, and she's over seven parishes now. I'm running for her three parish seat, Livingston, Tangipahoa, and St. Helena. Obviously, you know, I've been practicing law at a law firm for about a decade. I practice nationwide. I do work in federal court, appellate court, and 5 weeks ago, I argued a case in front of the Louisiana Supreme Court, which I believe is going to be a landmark case. I've done both criminal and civil law. I appreciate what y'all do on this board. I was raised in our public school system here in Louisiana and went to a public university and public law school. In addition, I have many family members who are principals and also school teachers that had a hand in raising me. So I appreciate what y'all do. If it wasn't for y'all, we would not have the education that our young people need nowadays. Obviously, if elected, I guarantee I'll make you proud. I'm going to work hard to make sure I bring the knowledge of me practicing in different courtrooms nationwide back home, to where I can bring even just the technology sectors to the systems that they run in those different court systems back home to hopefully improve our system. We have a great court system here, but I believe it could use a little bit of improvements. A little bit about myself. I was a president of the Bar Association for 2 years, so I was selected by my peers to do that. But besides that, I'm number 73 on the ballot. I'm not going to take a lot of y'all's time tonight. I look forward to meet each and every one of you individually that I have not met, and please answer any concerns you may have. First and foremost, I'm a Christian, and I appreciate your vote. And whenever you go to the polls, if you haven't already, because I know early voting already started, and like I said, I appreciate your time, and thank you for having me. Colt Four, number 73, when you go to the polls. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Four. All right. Item 3A, Ready Start Update. Ms. Brabham. You'll get 5 minutes as well. No, just be. It probably would be.
Good evening. I'm here to update you on our Ready Start Tangipahoa. I gave each of you a brochure. I had spoken about this on our last meeting that I attended, so I was able to go get those and show them to you today. So this is a blueprint. This is our talking point. So we established some goals. We have our vision, and our vision is paving the way for early learners cradle to kindergarten. And remember, this is a transition from our old Tangipahoa Early Childhood Community Network. It's the same entity. We're just now operating under Ready Start Tangipahoa. I'm a part of that organization, but I'm employed through Tangipahoa Parish School System. So we broke our blueprint down into this one pager because it's difficult. The blueprint is very long, so when you approach people to discuss what is early learning Tangipahoa, you don't want to give them a four-page document. So we worked with Antoine's, who created our website. I showed that to you last time I was here, and they created this for us. So as you can see, it's broken down our blueprint goals, curriculum for every classroom. And remember, when I'm speaking in this capacity, I'm talking about birth to 4 years old. So we're purchasing curriculum, not Tangi dollars. This is its own grant that's funding this. Infant curriculum, we're purchasing that for classrooms, toddler curriculum, and pre-K curriculum. We're training a group of people this week, actually. One of my coworkers, Melanie Sledge, is doing a training for toddlers. So we're training people to become toddler observers. So we have a lot of things going on. So once we get the curriculum, then we have to train the teachers on how to use that. And this does include Tangi teachers, because Tangi teachers are a part of our network. So that leads into our professional development. That's goal number two. Goal number three is to increase the number of early childhood seats. And four, provide more resources for our parents, because the younger we reach these children, the better prepared they are for their academic careers. So our whole goal as the state's goal is to prepare these students for kindergarten. We have a little data on the side over here. This data is from 2 years ago, because we had these published, or started working on the publishing rather, in the spring. So as you can see, the older the student, the larger percent we serve. So as they get younger and younger, we serve less of those children. So we're trying to get quality programs for the earliest learners. So I wanted to give this to you today to show to you, because we're going to have this information out in the public, because we are building our coalition. So remember our four pillars that we've talked about. We had to establish a blueprint, establish our coalition, work on our governance, and then the last pillar is fundraising. So we have established our coalition, which we're constantly building. Anyone interested in early childhood can come to our meetings. We meet bi-monthly. We've done this for years now, but we're just now advertising that. We have established an advisory committee. It's our old leadership team, so they're rebranded as an advisory committee. And that committee is like a steering committee, and we meet bi-monthly. But right now we're meeting monthly and even sometimes every week, because we're working on establishing our board of directors. So this is its own entity, Ready Start Change Behave. So we're looking for 9 board members to serve in this capacity. And this group needs to be a widely diverse group from all walks of life, so that we can see the needs of early childhood in Tangipahoa Parish and can come together to build that foundation for our early learners. So I wanted to come and give you this update so that you would see, if you see Ready Start Tangipahoa on a billboard, yeah, this is part of our work. We are part of that work in Tangipahoa Parish school system. I wanted to just give you some numbers. We have 54 public school classrooms. We have 128 child care classrooms and 41 Head Start classrooms. So as a total, we are observing 223 classrooms in our district, which makes it very busy. I think I have 3 observations a week until December. And as my schedule gets a little tighter, I push them, so sometimes 4. So that's why we're trying to train people to become observers, so we can be better prepared to handle this this very large task of observing every early childhood classroom in Tangi. So our next steps, we're going to establish this board, and we have a very ambitious goal. I thought it was really ambitious to have it established by January, but the state has contracted with an outside agency to help us with this work. And so I had a call Friday, and they pushed me to have it established before January. And I thought my January goal was ambitious, but apparently I need to be a little bit more ambitious. So that's why our steering committee, our advisory committee, is meeting a little more often. So we're trying to get that established before the end of the year. We're going to continue to build our coalition, which is what we're doing now. We're going to be reaching out to people in the parish and giving out these brochures, because we want parents to know what's available for their early learners. And we will request seats through our coordinated funding request, and so that gives us our funding for our program. And then we have a coordinated enrollment plan, which is part of this work. How do people know what's available to them? So we create a coordinated enrollment plan every year that we roll out, so that, and our website is part of that, so we can have parents that just move here, search early childhood, they can search daycare, they can search children, and Ready Start Tangipahoa pops up. And our number's on there, they can give us a call, and we steer them to their options that are available within their district or where they live. So, it's time for questions.
As a retired educator, I firmly believe in early childhood education. I think is critical. And just for clarification, so what is your definition when you speak of at-risk children?
At-risk children, the state determines that through their income eligibility as far as LA4 programs for our pre-K programs. So when we are talking about adding seats through this, they would have to provide income information, and that determines their at-risk.
Basically, at risk means the income situation.
Yes, ma'am. The state gives us a scale that we look at to see it's 200% above the poverty level is what the guideline is. So we have a chart that the parents provide their income. SNAP benefits are automatic qualifiers. Medicaid is an automatic qualifier, but again, there's a scale for Medicaid. It's dependent on that income as well.
Thank you so much.
And just 2 points that, you know, I wanted to emphasize here. One of the benefits of the Ready Start is for parents. You've already said that. But if you move into this area, or if you live in this area and you have young children that are not in kindergarten, you can go to one stop and find all the options for your child. And you have, it's like a streamlined process. And then the other benefit of this that I see is that you know, in prior, if you go back to that slide where it had how many classes we have, Cindy, like how many Head Start, how many daycare, prior to this, we really, it was more of a question of the quality that they were getting at these different sites. And so now we ensure that they have high quality curriculum, that when we observe, we're looking for certain standards and quality, we give feedback. So it's not just kids are just getting babysit, it's not babysitting, but it's actual learning that's preparing them to be ready for school. So I just wanted to me, I think those are like the two big headlines for this, is to help parents, and then it's going to help children be ready by ensuring that all of these agencies and all those little classrooms are doing things that's going to prepare kids for kindergarten. But
thank you. Perfect. Yes, ma'am. And they go through an accountability system just like the school. They use the mm-hmm. class tool, so you can go to School Finder and you can look up one of our centers, and their achievement levels are on there. So that's all the work that we do to try to get, because if you get those scores up, then children are learning more. So they go through our accountability system as well.
Mm-hmm. Is the contact information or number?
Yes, ma'am. On the very back.
Oh, I see it. I'm sorry.
That's my office, and I just direct people where they want to go. But if you go to the website, we've got every center and school that operating in our network. We have their web address. We have information about them, their star ratings, because, you know, schools are A, B, C, D. Well, centers are stars, 1 star, 2 star, 3 star, 4 star. So their stars are there. We even have our public school information on there, too. So if you have a 2-year-old and you have a 10-year-old, you can see all of your options on that one website.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am.
So this is registering for pre-K next year, registering for pre-K as well.
This is at this site.
This
is birth to
yes.
pre-K. So if I had an infant, they would go through the same process, and we would steer them to their location and what the child care center is available in their area and help them do the application.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I just want to thank you for your leadership. We never have to worry about this because, you know, Cormac and her team take care of all the details. They attend all everything. She keeps us updated. But it's going to be huge. And, of course, this is moving us into direction of being a universal pre-K one day, which we're almost there. We have 84% of our at-risk kids that are in pre-K.
You know, you're very impressive. You are when you speak to us. Thank you.
Very.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bradley.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, item 4A, update on our district athletic program. Mr. Vining, I'd ask Mr. Vining to come and give us an update on where we stand with athletics during the COVID crisis, some of the changes that some of the schools are implementing with their sports programs and how that's being received. And that way, if you have any questions, obviously we can steer them to the man that can answer them.
Well, as of right now, when it all began, first off, there's a bunch of people I want to thank. I want to thank Ms. Stilley and her direction, her administration, Brett finding the finances for us to get all the stuff that these schools needed when football started and athletics started to clean these facilities and things like that and keep these students safe. I want to thank Ms. Verna, all the time she's applied to it, this, you know, tracking kids and things like that. It is monumental. And as you can look, at these colleges, these pro facilities that have all these resources, and they're still having the issues. They're still having problems. We've been, thank the good Lord, very blessed.
You did well.
What we've
good
been
job,
involved
man.
With and things like that.
There,
but, we haven't experienced as much as it possibly could have taken place. So we have been very blessed with that. But like I said, it's taken a team. It's taken all of us working together and things like that. So it's been a wonderful thing. Right now with what's going on, we still have volleyball going on till the end of the month. It'll be winding down with high school volleyball. Junior high volleyball will be ending at the end of this month. We have junior high football going on. It just started. They have about 4 or 5 more weeks. High school football, about 4 or 5 more weeks before playoffs start. Of course, playoffs will start the week of Thanksgiving. And then we also see that the playoffs will go on till the championships will be the December 26th, 27th, and 28th, right after Christmas. So They're looking at now that they may not be able to play in the Superdome because of what the mayor has done with, but I just saw that she's allowing the Saints fans to come in, so they may still be allowed to be able to have the state championships in the Superdome.
Money talks, man.
Yeah.
So that's a big, all that money comes involved and things like that. It's very political, you know that. So they were looking at alternative venues, so that's all in play. What we're doing here, of course, with our football teams, we're down to 25% capacity that we're allowed to come in to the facility, indoor or outdoor. The principals are doing a wonderful job maintaining we have signs as they walk in, reminding the people what they're doing. If they have any symptoms, please, all those signs were put up. Dr. Hurst got those all together for us and things like that. The PA announcers are announcing throughout, please stay masked. The fans are staying socially distanced. Of course, immediate families are able to sit together. Their majority of them are keeping their mask on. Even the kids on the sidelines are keeping their mask on. So they're doing a wonderful job with coaches. You know, this has been an added thing on them. Not only are they having to coach, they have to also keep these kids focused and things like that, trying to stay safe and all that. So volleyball, same situations. They're cleaning balls periodically throughout the matches. So it's just like I said, we've embraced what we've had to do, and the coaches and administration are doing a wonderful job maintaining what we need to do and keep our kids safe. So any questions for me?
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
And this is not real related to everything, but the other day I was talking to a student at Ponchatoula High who wanted to go out for basketball, but he didn't have the money. I think it's $67 for the physical. Do we require the students to come up with that, right?
Well, they do. We have a free physical day, that's generated throughout the year. And they had the opportunity to come at that
time.
So
that counts?
Yes, but it's over. It's been done already.
Right.
But it is $67 to have a physical, and it is required before they ever try it. Yes, ma'am.
I remember years ago at Hammond High, I think some doctor in town would come to the high school and gave his services free so the guys wouldn't have to pay for that. But
North Oak still does that for us.
No, no.
And those kids that want to go, it's announced early, and they actually came to schools this year. They didn't do it at their official place. They actually came on campus. And if you ever get to talk to Ms. Sutton or any of those people that are involved with the North Oaks program, just tell them how much we appreciate it, because they came on site. They set up on our campuses, and they tested those kids, and they kept them socially distanced, so it worked really well. They tested a large number of kids this year for us.
So if they pay attention and go, then they don't have to pay to get someone else to do it.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. And that is the price North Oaks charges, is $67 for the fiscal.
Mr. Duncan?
Mr. Viner, we have something on our screen here. Is this something you prepared or that you're
this
talking
is
about?
This is what was asked. Yeah, this was prepared. Dr. Hurst asked me to prepare this. And these numbers, and I want to go address it a little bit. These numbers are skewed a little bit. This came from the spring semester, okay? And as you know, spring semester, with all the adjustments we had to do. So these numbers, these GPAs are going to be skewed a little bit. That 1.5 to 1.99 may be a little higher some years. It may be a little lower some years. But this was generated for this year. This goes with what the LHSAA requires these sports to prepare for the fall semester. Because in spring semester, you only have to pass 6 classes. There's no GPA required for spring sports. All spring sports, there's no GPA required. You just have to pass 6 classes.
Okay? For in the previous semester?
For the previous semester, that is correct.
Okay.
Fall semester, fall sports requires a grade point average. It has to be maintained. And LHSA says it is a C average.
So that was my first question, is that I didn't see baseball or basketball listed. And so that's because
we have
they
not addressed them. They will be addressed coming up in the near future.
And but that's because they have that different requirement that's not GPA related.
That is correct, yes, sir.
But before you go through these numbers, one question, because we had a constituent that had asked whether we would consider raising the GPA requirement. And so after that meeting, I went looking through our policy manual to see which one of our policies actually has a GPA requirement. And I couldn't find a board policy, and I was hoping you could, did I just miss it? Is it a different?
Well, it's always been through curriculum, academics, that LHSA requires a C average, is what they require of athletes. And what Tangible Repair School System recognizes a C average is a 1.5.
And so, but that's what I'm asking. So that 1.5 figure, it's not in our board policy, it's somewhere else? I mean, where would we go to find it?
I think it's in
the LHSA.
LH.
That's right.
That's what our schools are following, is the LHSAA guidelines related.
So if we wanted to put something that was more than the 1.5, I guess similar to what St. Tammany does, it would actually be a new policy that we would have to write, not revising one that currently exists.
Yes.
Okay, and that's what I wanted to confirm with you.
Yes.
Okay. All right, and then so then I guess if you would finish talking about your numbers.
Okay, and as you can see, the total number of athletes we have participating in football this year, now this is just 10th through 12th. Ninth graders aren't required GPAs right now, because they automatically, when they go in as a freshman, they're automatically eligible, okay? So their GPA is not calculated into this. So this is actually 10th through 12th graders that are calculated into these numbers, okay? For our football, for our seven high schools, and these are all high school numbers, this is not junior high, our high school numbers, we have 353 athletes playing football this year from 10th through 12th. As you can see, 1.5 to 1.9, we had 11 that fell in that category, okay? 2.0 to 2.9, 129, and of course, 3.0 to 4.0, we had 213. Then we go on to volleyball. Out of our seven high schools, we only have four schools that have volleyball at this time, that are playing volleyball. And so we had 50 players there, 50 students that participate. Four run into the 2.0 to 2.9, and 46 runs from your 3.0 to 4.0. Swimming, we only have two schools that participate in swimming, Ponchatoula and Hammond. We have 23 athletes involved in that. Six fall under the 2.0 to 2.9, and 17, 3.0 to 4.0. And then, of course, cross country, we only have two schools that participate in cross country. That's Hammond High and also Ponchatoula. The majority of Ponchatoula, I think Hammond only has one cross-country athlete. And so there's 14 of them that participate in it. And this, remember, this is 10th through 12th. They do have ninth graders that are participating in all these sports. So the amount of students, amount of athletes would increase, but we're just not showing them with the GPA. Of course, 14 run through the 3.0 to the 4.0.
So. Couple of them.
Mr. Duncan?
So tell me again, if we want, and again, because we're thinking about, I'm just thinking about this possible policy change. So the spring sports, so baseball and basketball, you said that in the prior semester they must have gotten six credits or passed.
That's correct.
So they have to have received or passed six credits, but then there's no GPA requirement.
No GPA requirement.
So if we were to put a GPA requirement, that would be in addition to what LHSAA says, I guess, which would be, so they would have to have the six credits that they passed and whatever GPA requirement
LHSAA
we wanted.
LHSAA does not require GPA.
Right, but if we wanted to have one.
Well, really, how do I say it? They don't require. So it's that kid could be legalistic, because they are the governing body over the athletic departments, okay, for all the schools, so they don't require it. So that would be a legal thing. That's above my pay grade.
Well, St. Tammany doesn't have they have that 2.0 requirement.
It's just for their fall sport.
That's only for their fall sport?
That's correct. That's
okay.
The only sports that require are your fall sports that require your GPAs.
All right, next question is, I know we have fairly limited extent, I guess only football, we have junior high athletes.
That's correct. We hold them to the same thing, 1.5.
Okay, but they don't, do they fall under LHSA?
I'm the governing body, pretty much.
Okay.
I watch over them, but they do, everything that we pretty much follow what LHSA does.
Okay, so there's for the football, and then to a limited degree basketball, I guess we have a few.
Yes, sir.
Junior high basketball programs, it's the same rules.
That's correct.
Okay, but if we wanted to put something in place GPA-wise?
Now, you could do that for junior high, and like I said, the LHSA wouldn't have anything to do with junior high.
Okay.
Like I said, I couldn't speak for that with the high school.
But okay. Correct me if I'm wrong, but our standards could always be higher than what the state recommends.
And I'm sure, it could be, but like I said, I don't know, legalistically, you know, it doesn't affect any, no, there's no other schools in the parish that, or school systems in the parish or state that do that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? That require spring sports to have a GPA.
But we could get those numbers starting in January, correct?
We can get the numbers, but like I said,
check it out.
They're not required to have a C average. They only have to pass six courses.
What is the reasoning behind that with the LHSAA? Do you know?
For spring sports? I couldn't tell you, dear.
I just don't understand that for a long time. That they would require football, volleyball, and all these other sports, but they don't require that from baseball and basketball.
I would assume.
A kid may not be eligible for the beginning of basketball, but he can get eligible when basketball starts, if he passes. See, he may not be eligible for fall sports, but if he passes six credits at midterm, then he can be eligible for basketball after midterm. So they can get eligible.
If they get on the team in the fall and they start practicing, what's the requirement to get on the team if they haven't passed their six credits?
Well, they may have been on the team already, okay, and they may not have been eligible to participate in athletic. This is 10th, 11th, and 12th graders again. They may have gotten on as a ninth grader, okay, and they were on the team, and coach, you know, has kept them on the team, and then, of course, they didn't pass and be eligible for the fall at the beginning of the season, but they can get eligible if they pass six credits.
But that's what I'm asking is, how do they even practice in the fall if
they can't practice with the team?
Until January,
they get eligible.
Okay. So we've had those instances where
all the time.
Okay.
I just have one more. I know this is but once you get there in the fall and you're eligible, the progress reports every 9 weeks doesn't count.
Right. Once you're eligible in the fall.
It's only the semester.
Yeah, that's correct. You're eligible until midterm.
To midterm.
If you pass six credits, no GPA, if you pass six credits.
I'd like to see those numbers for our spring sports kids. This is really good. Thank you for giving this to us.
I have a question. So are there any strategies, any programs to help those athletes who are falling below this 1.5?
Several schools do have study time. You know, a lot of schools have it before practice. If a coach is watching, and we did this too, if we're watching a kid and they're struggling and the school allows them after school tutoring, they'll go to the after school tutoring and then come to practice later on.
So this is an individual school.
That's correct.
So why don't
the school system don't have anything in place?
Okay, so why is it that we don't have something that's across the board?
I couldn't tell you.
Well, hold up. Before we go any further, on the agenda, of course, we asked Mr. Vining to come up and give us an athletic update. Also want to make sure the record indicates that Ms. Richards is here. But before we get into a debate about the policies, which this is all good discussion, and before we get to back and forth as far as what works and what doesn't work, what I'd like to propose is between now and the next meeting, we form a committee to look into this. And on that committee, I would like volunteers from the board that would like to participate, as well as Mr. Vining, as well as people, stakeholders like Mr. Marshall, as well as coaches, because I know the coaches have reached out and they want to have a voice in this too. I would like to bring a list of names back to the board for board approval for next meeting of a committee to look at this and get into the nuts and bolts of why we do what we do, so that we can come back to the board with a recommendation from a committee of stakeholders, coaches, and board members. Would that be appropriate, Mr. Duncan?
Well, of course, you can. I mean, I think that's a perfectly good idea. I would point out that the next on the, or coming up later on in this agenda, there is a policy that is being referred to the policy committee where we could insert some language requiring minimum GPA. So that policy is being referred,
right.
That we could amend, and I don't know when the policy committee plans on coming back, calling that meeting, but I've just mentioned that as far as a timeline is concerned, if
right.
we wanted to try to do something that soon, or if we wanted to take a different, you know, more lengthy approach, that's fine too.
Does that satisfy most of the questions of the board before we get into a debate on the policy itself?
Yes.
Since we're not really ready for that debate yet?
As the chairman of it, I certainly agree with you and would like to have that.
And Mr. Marshall, would you be okay with serving on that committee as well?
Oh, I would love to. Okay. I could also answer the question that the school board members asked too, if you wanted to know that. Why
well, I'd really, I don't want to get into it.
Well, I didn't know if you were doing that.
That's
why
you were asking
the question.
Ms. Dillon?
Yes, I just want to say that, you know, we are reconvening to develop a strategic plan. You know, we initially did one back in 2018. It's 2 years old. We've pretty much done most of the things on there. And I've already met with several departments, but this assistance for athletes and their academic grades in terms of a district-wide approach to helping those students, even starting in junior high, before they get into high school, is something we want to include in our strategic plan, and we'll be bringing that to the board for approval. That also will get feedback from employees. We'll have it on our website for parents to give feedback, community members, before the board would take final approval of that or consider final approval of that in December, or it's probably going to be the first meeting in January, actually, before we have it completely ready for board approval. That's the plan, but I think if there's a need to agree with Mr. Moore, that even though we have schools and coaches across the district that do different types of things with their players, you know, to check grades and help them and reinforce, pull their grade point averages up, I think that we need a district-wide approach with non-negotiables for every school, and then some schools may go above and beyond and do other things as well. So I just wanted to mention that.
Okay.
I just had one, because it's just a burning. When do we do basketball tryouts and select the team? When is that generally done?
They're probably supposed to start.
They're doing it right now.
So, like, we do that in the fall.
Yes, sir.
And so what you're telling me is that the coaches select their players for the spring without regard to what their GPA is at all, with the hope that whoever they select will ultimately qualify to play in the spring.
And of course, they're checking their grades now. They're seeing, you know, they can pretty much gear or gauge where the kid's going to fall right now.
Okay.
You know, he's going to be able to pass 6 credits.
So, but what happens to the kids that don't make the team but they had the grades versus, and then say we have a kid that makes the team but then ends up not being able to academically qualify? We just lose out on having that spot filled? I mean, how does that work?
Well, like I said, a lot of times, you know, they may, it just depends. You know, a lot of times they don't even know how many football players are going to come out for the basketball teams right now too. So that has a big sway too, the number of kids that are coming out with the football team, because of course the football players can't try out for basketball right now. But I understand, so a lot of times, you know, those kids, there is a rubric they use to, you know, at tryouts.
So the coaches have to figure that out.
That is correct.
And sometimes they just take the risk.
If somebody comes back and questions them, they have to show why this kid did not make the team or not.
And why a kid that doesn't academically qualify did make the team.
That's correct.
So they have to justify that.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Okay.
They've been called wrong several times, and they have to have something, and we require them to have something in place to show why this kid didn't make it and why this kid did make it.
All right. Well, thank you. I'm learning something.
Any other questions for Mr. Vining? Mr. Marshall, I know you're chomping at the bits, but just keep in mind, there will be a time where we will debate this in a committee level to bring it to the board. I'm not trying to ignore you by no means, but we can't take public input on this item because it's not officially an item yet to be debated. So I hope you understand the side of that. Anything else?
We need a nomination for this?
No, I'll get with everybody. If anybody would like to participate in that committee, please let me know before the next meeting so that I can compile that list. And then I'll be getting with Mr. Marshall and get some stakeholders as well as the coaches.
Remember, the football, those coaches, a lot of them, they're really getting busy right now.
This is their busy time.
Exactly.
Right. Absolutely, will do. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the input. All right, item 5A, Finance Committee from October 6, 2020. Do I hear a motion to accept that committee report?
I make a motion to accept.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Dominguez, seconded by Mr. Westmoreland. Any discussion? Public input? Hearing none, we'll vote electronically.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. Item 6, A, B, and C, Superintendent's Report. Ms. Dilley. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. President. First item, A, is to ask the board to consider approval of a revised job description for transportation coordinator. And just to give you a little background information, we've been meeting and working with transportation to really look at what the issues are and how to redesign that department. I had a meeting with Mr. Muse and Dr. Hurst last week. They will have a big part in our strategic plan in terms of transportation, and there are several things that you'll see in that plan that will address some of our issues and challenges that we've had in transportation. One of the things that we've done is we've had vacancies for transportation coordinators, and we've met. We had Dr. Hurst, Mr. Muse, we've had Mr. Schnattelbach, Mr. Jenko, and myself have met several times, and we've had several revisions and drafts of this particular job advertisement or job description, I should say. And this is the one that we settled with because we feel like it meets the needs of what we need in transportation as transportation coordinators. And the difference between this particular job description and the previous job description for bus driver, for the transportation coordinator is that one, it requires a bachelor's degree, two, The prior job description said high school diploma and then / bachelor's degree preferred. Secondly, this employee would be an exempt employee under the labor law, which means that they're a 24/7 employee. There's no overtime, you know, there's no weekend pay. This job in particular has a lot of activities and things that will happen before 8 o'clock in the morning, after 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and on the weekends. And so this is a position that needs to be in the exempt category so that they're there at all times to assist. The third thing that I think is important here in this job description that's a little different is that there's an emphasis here on protecting the district from liability in terms of the paperwork that's necessary to protect us from accidents and legal, whenever we have to go to court for any kind of accident. There's certain documents that we've got to have on every bus. And so all of this is a big part of this. This is a management position. They will be overseeing teams of bus drivers and managing those drivers on a day-to-day basis. And the last point I want to make about this revision that I personally think is super important is that currently in our transportation department, if we have a vacancy in the director's position, if the director were to retire, be fired, leave, whatever, there would be no one in that department eligible to apply to be director because none of them would have degrees in the past. And that's a problem, because then you're bringing someone in from outside that's cold, that basically has not worked within the transportation department at all, and are not familiar with, you know, the transfers, all the transfers we have for students. They're not familiar with a lot of the roads, the routes, different things like that. So we feel like that by having individuals in that department that are degreed, that are eligible to apply for that director's position, will give us some sustainability. It will build capacity. I mean, it doesn't mean that others from outside can't apply, obviously, but you do have individuals within that department that have experience and they have knowledge in order to apply for that director position. The pay for the requiring a bachelor's degree is more for these transportation coordinators than they would be if they just had a diploma. It's actually about $12,000 more a year, but they're also 724. You know, they're on call on the weekend, after hours, and I think that that's a reasonable amount to pay an individual who is exempt and is on that criteria. You know, transportation is a $14.5 million budget, and we have one manager who has a degree, and that's Mr. Muse. That's it. And I don't think it's adequate, and I think that these individuals need to be degreed. They need to have experience in either logistics, transportation, or experience in management, or both. And we're hoping that by the board approving this, we can begin advertising and we can seek applicants that fit these qualifications. One of the things that we talked about on our team a lot as we were developing this is, you know, we're not developing a job description for a person. We're developing a job description on what we need in that department. And then we're gonna hope and pray that we have applicants that fit these qualifications and that will apply. So I ask the board to consider approval of this description and take any questions you might have.
Mr. Duncan.
No, I'll make the motion to adopt the administration.
Move to adopt administration's recommendation, but I do have a question.
Mm-hmm. Okay, motion by Mr. Duncan.
I'll second it.
Second by Ms. Simmons.
Ms. Stille, I just wanted to make sure that this is a position that already exists. Is that correct?
Yes.
We're not creating a new position.
No, currently we have three transportation coordinators.
And you said we have vacancies?
Three. We have three vacancies.
So we had this position in the past, but we've just kept them vacant?
No, they just became vacant.
Oh, they just became
vacant.
Yes,
they just became vacant. That's correct.
Okay.
So we have three vacancies.
And then the increase salaries, are with that increase in salaries, are we still within our current budget for that department? Or we're not increasing, we're not giving more money to the department? I wanted to make
that. No. So I'm glad you asked that question. Okay. So with the increase, and we've had this conversation and, you know, with our team, that what we want to do is advertise for two, because you have two degreed individuals instead of three not degreed individuals. So we would advertise for two when we put the advertisement out, and that would be well within our budget. I'm sorry, I thought we said we were gonna advertise for three.
Ms. Sully, I don't mean to question, but I feel you need all three positions based off the workload. The budget that is set aside for your transportation can absorb the additional $12,000 per
position. My understanding was that there was, even with those other positions at the lower salary, that there was a significant amount of money that was also being spent within the transportation department for overtime and green sheet time and things like that, so that we were still going to be
offset the additional increase.
Okay. Well, if it's within our budget, I think we should do the three as well.
Yes.
I was thinking that it would be over our budget.
On this department with 300 employees and having one management person supervising them is enormous.
Okay.
Yeah.
So with the $12,000 increase, how much is a salary? What is it?
What is starting pay for a
hold on a second.
Coordinator?
How much?
It ranges from 44.
44.
274 to 51 to 127. Is that the higher?
Thank you.
Okay, just I wanted to, and I sent Ms. Dilley a response on this, and I feel really strong about it. I do understand everything that we're trying to do with the job description, but one concern that I do have is right now we have, for instance, we have three field coordinators that just left. Apparently none of them had a degree. Well, somebody felt that they had enough experience to do the job without having a degree. Now, I love degrees and I love people that get degrees and I promote that, and I think kids could go to school, should go to school and get degrees. But I think we should still give an out for experience. And I give you an example. Have a bus driver in my community who owns a small business, a repair shop. She runs payroll, she runs scheduling, she does, you know, it's a multi-million dollar business, and she drives a bus for our insurance. I don't think she has a degree, but I know she's accomplished at that. Now, I don't know that she would ever want to come work for us, probably wouldn't, because she makes more money on her own, but we're telling her that you're not good enough because you don't have a bachelor's degree. I understand the thought that y'all are going toward, but I think that we're limiting ourselves out of experienced people. We have bus drivers that have been driving for, I think we should have some type of criteria in there, that a bachelor's degree or 10 years on a bus, a bachelor's degree or 15 years on a bus.
Experience.
I understand the management side and I understand, but I can tell you right now that we have bus drivers that are fully capable of moving into management that would not have a bus, would not have a chance because of this lack of degree.
I know that even among federal employees and federal agencies, they consider 4 years experience a year of college. You know, for an employee who has 20 years, that would be an equivalent. That experience would make them, their knowledge and their understanding and their ability to do the job equivalent to someone who had 4 years of intensified training. So I think that we could probably, you know, give consideration to what Tom is saying.
Yeah, because we, you know, and I'm not knocking anybody that we've hired, but we have filled this position, the director's position, before because of a degree over experience. And that has led to continual problems through transportation, and everybody knows that this is, for instance, one of the best transportation directors we've got, that we've had, is sitting in this room. Everybody says, Mr. Snodelbach did a great job as transportation. And I'm patting you on the back. But he probably would have never been, if we didn't know him, we would not have selected him to be our director, because he's got no logistics, he's accounting. I mean, what the heck, he's an accountant. So you see what I'm saying? Experience means something to me in this, and I'm gonna fight adamant for that, because I know there's bus drivers out there that are gonna blow my phone up tomorrow and say, oh, so I never got a chance to move up in this system. My experience means nothing.
I have a question as well. What is the difference in, okay, if we didn't have a person with a degree, the people we had in the field now, with all of their overtime, and that, does that equal $12,000 a year? With all of the overtime we've paid them?
Not 12, but it ranges between $4,000 and $8,000.
Okay, so I'm not understanding why we wouldn't consider somebody without a degree, even though they're working all of that overtime, they're still going to be costing us less than hiring somebody with a degree.
Yep. Because they weren't management. They didn't manage people. They were coordinators that trained the previous coordinators, trained drivers to drive school buses, and they coordinated routes and such, but the department needs additional management, like we have in other large departments that manage. Like a principal who supervises 100 teachers has assistant principals. We have a manager who runs that department who has a degree, but everybody in the department does not. He needs additional management skilled individuals. A bus driver who drives for, and they may shoot me up and down, but they drive a school bus for 5-10 years, doesn't know how to manage people. They know how to drive a school bus and know how to manage kids and know how to do that, but they don't have management experience. This department needs that management experience
to go ahead and manage the large group of people, to deal with parents, to deal with principals, to go out to an accident scene and control the accident scene, to go to a meeting with a parent or a student who has misbehaved and manage the meeting with the principal. A lot of times the school administration is putting the discipline issues on the coordinators. Those coordinators need to have that ability to handle the discipline and manage the situation. It is not as simple as it was 15, 20 years ago. It's much more complicated with the DSEG requirements, the transportation, the transfers, and all the other things that we're putting on them. Add to it the fact that, you know, when I supervised the department, we were 100% contract drivers when I first started. And we gradually moved to board-owning buses, where we ended up with about 30 to 50 board-owned buses. Now we're having 125 to 130. We're going to be coming to this board in a few months, probably, asking for an individual mechanic to repair the school buses that we have. We're going to be asking in the near future, probably within the next 2 to 3 years, for a mechanic shop, and then for maybe a mechanic director. So that department's going to grow, because we are now we're only buying the buses. The contract drivers can't afford to buy buses. The buses are too expensive, coming in at $70,000 and $80,000 a year. So department has grown and changed over the last 15 years, and it will continue to change as we go. We need young people to come in. I don't mean age discrimination. I mean people with experience that can grow with the department and that could be here for the long term. As Ms. Dilley said, we have one management individual, and if Mr. Muse would go or walk away from the job tomorrow, we would come in with no experience at all.
Well, what I have to agree with Tom, though, why not look for somebody that has the experience in management and logistics? Why does it have to just be a bachelor's degree? Why can't it be one or the other?
Facilities asking for the management, asking for logistics, asking for management experience.
Right. But since we're going to fill three, could it possibly be that we could take one bachelor's, one manager, and then two coordinators?
Can I
let her go finish, Ms. Richard?
Well, go ahead.
Right.
If you're through.
Yeah, and then that would give the opportunity for the non-degreed and our experience to also move up into the management, and they could work toward it.
And that's a possibility, Ms. Richards. But keep in mind, if you're giving hope to the 300 drivers who are driving the school buses today, mm-hmm. that they'll fill in one position that will be a non-degreed position. And once that position's filled, and it's going to be filled for the long term, 5, 10, 15 years, then you're not giving much hope to the other drivers. It's not going from a transportation driver to a position in the transportation department is not much of a progression when you only have one or two or even three vacancies.
Okay, but if you fill all three of them with a degreed person, then there is just no opportunity.
Well, that's correct.
Well, I think the opportunity for bus drivers as well is, and I think this is something we need to move toward, which is, you know, offering them additional funding to help with training new bus drivers, having, you know, how they have to do so many hours of someone riding their bus, maybe they get stipends. That all needs to be part of our plan moving forward as well for our bus drivers, because they can help us build capacity. As just like we have teacher leaders, there should be drivers that are there that can help us train new drivers and get experience on their buses.
Mr. Duncan?
I want to first say that I agree with Mr. Toler's point that there are certainly plenty of things instances in my life where I have seen excellent people with excellent experience that do an excellent job that don't have degrees. But on this particular request, one thing I think I guess would caution the board on is that with transportation, this board has come down really hard on administration and said, hey, this is a real problem. The way we have been doing it in the past is not working, and we have tasked the superintendent, who is our only employee, with fixing that problem, right? And I think for whatever reason, the transportation department over the last few years has kind of had a more political nature to it than the rest of our system. There's been multiple instances in the time that I've been on the board where politics has entered into decisions that have been made in that department. And so I think because of that, we have to accept responsibility for some of the problems that we have been reporting to the administration. This is an instance where the administration has said, hey, you gave me the task of fixing this problem. These are the recommendations that I think need to be implemented so that the superintendent can make those fixes. If we come in here as a board now and say, well, you know, but we want to micromanage your solution, then we don't get any further after today. If we micromanage the superintendent's solution, we don't have cover to complain about the fact that she wasn't able to adequately solve the problem that we asked her to solve. So, you know, she's asking for the latitude to make the improvements that she thinks needs to be made. And I don't think we can hold her accountable for failure if we don't give her the solution that she's asking for.
Mr. Dominguez?
I think the job description is good, but I would like to give kudos to the three field coordinators that just decided to do something different. I think they did a great job, but I said it time and time again, they didn't need to be driving the bus. They needed to be doing their job. Our department didn't have enough bus drivers, so they had to fill in. We had a lot of people just decide they didn't want to drive a bus anymore because of the route they got and left, which left our field coordinators to go drive a bus. I think they did a great job. I think what they did is a lot of the stuff that's listed in this list. But until we get bus drivers, which I don't even know what miracle that's going to be, the field coordinators or director of transportation, whatever you want to call them, cannot do their job if they're driving a bus for 4 hours a day. It's as simple as that. So, I mean, I have to agree with the bachelor deal because there's a lot of people that don't have degrees that do excellent work for us. So it does limit the capabilities of somebody who is very managerial in their job that could do this job without a bachelor's degree. But until we give them the bus drivers to actually manage, we're never going to get a good solution is what
my worry is that we're limiting ourselves and we're cutting potential stars out by putting that limit. That's my concern.
Are these field coordinators will be required to drive the bus also?
They will have the skills to do that, but they are not expected to drive.
Yeah, this is what I'm hearing. I'm hearing that we need more management, obviously, to help Mr. Mutes, but we also want to keep our field coordinators. Can we have new positions? Can we start a new position where Mr. Muse is in some management and then field coordinators here? Can we add 72 more, you know, 80,000, 90 more thousand to that budget and hire these two managers that we need to help Mr. Muse manage the thing? Because you're right, he needs help. But also keep our three field coordinators like we have right now. They can drive the bus, don't have to have a degree, experienced drivers, know the routes. That might be something we might could kick around.
When we met on Friday, Thursday of last week, you know, one of the things that we've been doing the last 2 years is trying to get more drivers. And we've had multiple trainings. I mean, a lot of stuff happening. We really, based on the meeting that we had last week, we have more of an attendance problem than we have a bus driver, lack of bus driver problem. Hmm. And so we are developing a plan to address that. But we have an attendance problem. That's what we have.
Hmm. Any other questions? We have a motion and a second on the floor. I'm sorry, Mr. Dominguez.
Is there a way that, what was it, Mr. Abrams, you said something about having either or in there? I mean, if they have a lot of experience or so many years experience in managerial, that they wouldn't have to have a degree?
I just think if we had somebody that had management experience, let's say 25 years of management experience, but they had no bachelor's degree, I'm just thinking that we're cutting ourselves off if we're insisting on all three of these positions have to have a bachelor's degree. I tend to agree with Mr. Toler. Why do we have to have all three of them with a bachelor's degree? Why can't we do maybe two and one without a bachelor's degree? I'll even agree to two of them. You know,
well, in the current, but again, that's what we were doing. What y'all are asking is that we keep.
No, what we were doing is we had all three without a bachelor's degree.
Right. Okay.
Well, before all three of them were recommended, we were hoping for, and that's the difference. The options are, at this point, we can vote on the motion that's on the floor, or we can entertain a substitute motion where you would add or take away something to the administration's recommendation. That's where we're at today.
And I think we need to let our administration administer our departments, particularly when we've come down so hard on them on finding a solution. We need to let them implement their solution to the problem before we go in and try to micromanage or change it.
Okay. Any other questions? Call for question.
Online voting is open. Online voting is closed. Motion passes with Mr. Toler and Ms. Abrams voting no.
But Mr. Toler, I'm sorry, Mr. President, but I would like to add, I would like to keep coming back to us with maybe two more spots, like just bus drivers that, and have another name for them or something. I think we need more people in that department.
We're developing a strategic plan that will be brought to the board for approval by January, first meeting of January. And in that plan, you will see opportunities for current bus drivers to earn additional money and do leadership type positions.
Thank you.
Item 6B, would I like to ask the board to consider canceling the November 3rd board meeting due to the presidential general and open congressional primary election. That's the board meeting night, and just, you know, ask the board to consider that cancellation.
You need a motion for that? I'll make the motion that we change the meeting.
Second.
Change the meeting or cancel the meeting?
Cancel. Well, cancel that meeting.
Cancel, I'm sorry. Did
completely.
I say change?
I'm sorry.
She said change.
Yeah.
Okay, so motion made by Ms. Simmons, seconded down his way.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Electronic voting. Any discussion?
Can Mr. Toler and I still meet and argue somewhere else? I mean,
say again.
How are we going to get along if we don't argue that night? What are we going to do, man?
I'm sure we'll find a way.
Meet PJs and do something else?
I'm sure we can find a way.
All right, you know I love you.
We're going to vote on that one?
Online voting is open.
Item 6.
Online voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. Item 6C, consider approval. We're continuing with the review of our policy with Forethought. As you may recall, they've been reviewing our policy and looking for policies that need to be deleted or revised or recommending new policies. And then our leadership team gets together, I think every 2 weeks, right? Every 2 weeks. And we review the Forethought recommendations, and then we get ready to ask you guys to revert to policy. So this is where we are with consider approval to refer the summary assessment revisions to Section J, which is students, from Forethought to the policy committee.
So moved.
Motion by Mr. Duncan.
Second.
Second by Mr. Westmoreland. Any discussion, questions, public input? Electronic voting, please.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
All right. Still, anything else?
Mm-mm. No, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Board member comments, starting to my right, Dominguez.
Yes, just want to remind the board members, I think you may have gotten, I'm sure you've gotten the emails if you read them. State School Board Association is actually having a live and in-person workshop next week in Alexandria. If you're interested in going for that to get your training, can let Ms. Cindy Jenkins know. And also, we had a Zoom meeting workshop a couple of weeks ago, and we had some information from several key people from the State Department, and it was great. We got some training hours for that, so you can actually go online and look at it now if you'd like to. So that was all. Just thank you, wanted to remind you all of that. Make sure you get your training hours in before the year's over.
More?
Okay. Okay, and my comments are going to be basically the same as they've been for the last few board meetings, and they're going to be concerned with going to be about the distant learning. I am in this unique position where I'm both a guardian for a young student, and I'm seeing on the other side the issues that are facing our teachers and our principals and our administrators. And this is just something that everybody in the country is struggling with. And my frustrations, you know, with dealing with the inexperience of the entire system has come down to one comment, and that is be patient, be inquisitive, you know. Parents, you know, email and communicate with the teachers and the principals. And teachers, please, you know, to take to heart the struggles of the parents and the apprehensions that parents have about having their children in school, and you know that even when the kids are in your classroom, it's a struggle. So you can just imagine what the parents are dealing with at home. My prayers are that we are going to find a way to get through this and overcome it, and everybody's going to survive it, and we're going to move on after this pandemic is over.
Thank you.
I'm just going to remind everyone that starting next Friday, Penny Power starts in the schools with TARC. It'll be the Ponchatoula schools, Hammond East Side, Hammond West Side. So those are the individual schools that'll be going for next Friday, which will start on the 30th. They'll start next Monday all the way to Friday.
Okay. And I'll add just as a reminder to address the GPA question as far as what we want to do with that. I'd like anybody that would like to participate, please send me a text, let me know that you want to participate, and then we'll form that committee and we'll come and ratify that committee, the names for our next meeting, which will be the second meeting in November. So, Ms. Richard? Simmons?
Yeah, two things. One is I can't tell you how impressed I am with Mrs. Vera coming here meeting after meeting, sitting back there. I asked one time, Ms. Steele, I said, who is this that keeps coming? And I'm just so impressed that she would be that dedicated to be here. And of course, congratulations on her award tonight. And then the other thing is on the sports line, you know, we've had several graduates from high schools that have played football for NFL, and this is not the first one, but I watched the Alabama game the other night, and Devontae Smith, number 6, right, wide receiver, I was just so amazed. And of course, I called the school, called the coach, and cut out all his stuff and sent it to him. I mean, we should be so proud of our young people, not just in sports, I know that, but I love sports and I love watching football, and I just was just so amazed to see the talent of this young man, and he was one of ours. And I was just so proud of that situation. And I think we have a couple from Ponchatoula at LSU, maybe Finley, and one more maybe. I know.
Last night, Arizona Cardinals, Reginald Sanders.
Reginald Sanders. I'm sorry, I forgot him. But anyway, I'm just proud of these guys. That's all.
Mr. Bush? Ms. Dilley? Any public input turned in? No, hearing none. Meeting adjourned. Thank y'all.